Hello there, everyone, and welcome back to TNO, the last news of Europe. I'm your host, Mr. McClubber, and right now we need to talk about the attaché. The U.S. Army base hustled with activity as soldiers prepared for the military exercise. Roman Sidorov was excited to see the army in action after coming to America as a military attaché. One of the many bases surrounding Washington, D.C., this one was a special, as it was one of the only that had monthly base-wide military exercises. "This must be Sergeant Roman Sidorov," said a man with a large green cap, walking towards Roman with his hands outstretched. "I am Colonel Grayson Garnes, commander of this base. I'm glad you could visit." "It's good to meet you, Colonel." Roman paused for a moment. He knew basic English, but he was no fluent speaker. "I was very interested in viewing your training exercise today. Would you care if I watched?" "Of course you can watch. It is your job, isn't it?" said Garnes. "Follow me. There's an excellent viewing platform a few yards away. I'm sure you'll enjoy seeing today's exercise." Roman climbed the platform with the commander, and a few minutes later, the action began. The base had been divided into two teams, red and blue, and the army was practicing tank tactics and mobility warfare. Roman watched the American tanks speed across the fields and dodge obstacles while still firing shells constantly. They seemed invincible, he thought. He had to get these tactics back to Sverdlovsk. "Tank warfare would be necessary in Russia. You enjoying it, Roman?" the commander said. "These tanks are newly developed, just off the production lines. They'll be the first things those Germans or Japanese see in a fight with the U.S. Army. We definitely don't have anything like that back in Russia. The tactics themselves are new to us. I'm sure my commander back home will be most pleased with what I've learned here in America." "Well, it's good to hear. Just don't let those notes drop into German hands on your way home, all right? We will surely benefit from these tactics, and we're still kind of doing into the world." I think I did read the Sverdlovsk tank factory last time, so if you'd like to read about this one again, please go right ahead. And I believe I also read about quality materials. I believe I did read this one as well. So if you want to read this one as well, please go right ahead. But first, the tank factory, and I'll let you guys read this if you want to once again. Cool. Hope you guys are having a pretty good day. We got a couple comms to go through. And there goes the UK. And now they're going to play their little event. "The important thing is not what they think of me, but what I think of them," says Queen Victoria. Rule Britannia, and we got to spend some more for our budget. Because we love spending money here. Yeah, love spending money, and it's almost 69, so that's actually pretty darn good for us. Let's see, someone says, actually a lot of people say, to serve Russia. Yes, to serve Russia, as well as someone's talking about the Soviet Federation of Western Russia. Apparently, Komi under Zhdanov can unite with a WRRF if... the Zhukov leads a WRRF, so I didn't know that. I really didn't know that, so that's actually kind of cool. It's pretty darn cool that they can unite, so that makes sense. I need to play as Adonis sometime. I think I will. I don't know. Let's see what happens, because Komi has so many different leaders, so if you like to hear about this, once like I said, please go right ahead. But armor improvements, but let's go and read something else, such as the cream of the crop. "Our officer corps has become widely known as the finest in Russia, but can the hundreds of thousands of troops they command be held up to the same standard? The reforms made to the Army's training standards provided a devastatingly effective body of troops during the war against the revisionist and insidious Black League. But the reality is that the stakes have risen considerably since our victory, and even more powerful foes now surround us on all sides." My apologies, but I need to do this real quick. And we'll just go ahead and choose this. Thank you. My apologies. "Therefore, even more wide-ranging overhauls of the training regimen are to be enacted. Our troops already in possession of considerable skill will be pushed to the very limits of the capabilities with a new series of recruitment standards and training routines. The Third Army shall transform into a crack force consisting of the cream of the West Siberia's crop, the very best fighting men the region can muster. We simply cannot accept any less. And we can improve training methods, which would be cool. Get more organization, attack, less losses, less planning speed, more reconnaissance, and better training penalty reductions. Sounds pretty darn decent to us." Very good. And what can we do now? Oh, we can prepare for... Oh! We'll begin unification talks. We can try that out. We have a lot more weight than they do, which is good to see. How about a non-aggression agreement? Anything down here? No? Alright, that's fine with us. And let's go ahead and do extending olive branch. If you're wondering about that, please go right ahead. But mechanized troop training. "During the war, the Kaganovich is revisionist. His large contingent of motorized forces proved a formidable obstacle for our troops, who mostly fought while slogging it out on foot, to tackle. Although we secured a hard-fought victory in the end, our foes had taught us an important lesson even in their defeat. Mechanization of the ground forces is an absolute necessity, and mechanized units lay the bedrock of any serious modern military." Ooh, LBJ. "Comparatively, what little mechanized forces we currently possess are woefully inadequate for the wars of tomorrow. In order to create a truly modern force, the army as a whole must begin to adopt new training methods, focus on the practical use of highly mobile mechanized units, so that we may be better acclimated to the battlefield of the future." Oh, the proposed board treaty? Aw, sure. That sounds pretty good to us. And we have another option here. Oh, it was this one too. Diplomatic standing? We could. Eh, why not? Tension's 15, receptiveness is 25. Cream of the crop is done, and mechanized troops and some better trucks. What's not to love? And we do have a cup of coffee here to keep us nice and warm. Marinos. The Legacy of the Third Army. When we made our desperate escape from the tyrannical reign of Kaganovich and his republic, the decorated Third Army formed the bulk of our armed forces. Through thick and thin, the brave men and women of this army led our statelet from victory to victory, securing a lasting peace for the people of Siberia. With more conflicts on the horizon, the veterans of the Third will no doubt have the opportunity to write even more chapters in the triumphant history. The Third Army is more than just our most elite force. It is a heroic symbol of everything our new Red Army now stands for. The hefty legacy this army has already established shall serve as a model of all of our future armies to follow, with the Third becoming a bright, shining beacon of honor and discipline for our noble troops to aspire to. Hey, the nap accepted. Look at that, great. The obstacles of war. The men stood on the line, facing the obstacle course that lay ahead. All were fresh and recruits ready to join the Third Army and defend the military district. The drill instructor looked at each one in the eye, seeing the same faces every time he saw he trained a new batch of recruits. It seemed just like yesterday he had trained that poor runt Kirill, working him hard until he was finally promoted to a soldier. He never got to see him again, but Kutuzov felt like he was trained well enough to have survived the wars. Now let's go ahead and do... Oh. He wasn't here to make feel sorry for those boys, though. He was here to train them. Alright, boys, listen here, the instructor yelled. He was older, but his voice was still strong. I know we've already met, but if any of you morons forgot my name already, my name is Sergeant Kutuzov. Today, you'll be drilling, not for speed, but for determination. This course is one of the most challenging in the district. Towering walls, barbed wire, and deep mud will all stop you from getting to the finish. But you will not give up. This training will not end until every single one of you reaches the end. Now look at that. That looks really good. Kutuzov continued to look every man in the eye, pacing in front of them, wanting to get his point across. A soldier in the field doesn't just need speed, strength, or agility to win the fight. They need the determination to win. If a man isn't determined to beat the enemy, he will either lose or die. You must match your skills with determination to become victorious. Giving up is not an option in these wars these days. If you give up in the field, this district and everything we have fought for up to this point will have been for nothing. Do you understand? Yes, sir, the men shouted in unison. Well then, what are you waiting for? Go! The sergeant shouted, watching the boys run into obstacle course, each bent on reaching the finish first. Determination is half the battle, and improved training methods. If you'd like to read about the status, which we had before, please go right ahead. Lose mobilization speed, minimum training level goes up, but better army professionalism training, way more attack and defense, organization, that looks really great. Awesome. That's going to take a month. Hey, get better standards. Sign us up, and now we got this as well. Great. Agriculture, academic base, research facilities, industrial expertise. Awesome, awesome. Legacy of the Third Army. Yes, that'll be good to do. We'll go, probably have some more stuff right there to do first, and have some coffee too. We could cut down on military spending, but now we're okay. Alright, sounds pretty good to us. Stockholm Conference succeeds, great for them. Yeah, we can't build any more cities, so we'll build a lot of roads up, so then we can build more cities. Followed up with... the Rokossovsky Military Academy. Why not? Konstantin Rokossovsky was more than just a general. He was a man who secured the safety of Sverdlovsk people and heroically turned the tables on the tyrants who oppressed them. Even now, the line of Siberia's brilliant strategies have a great deal of influence in our armies, and without his wise leadership, we wouldn't have achieved nearly the same level of success within and without. To honor the recently departed Marshal, the Rokossovsky Military Academy will open its doors in Sverdlovsk. This place is of martial learning shall be the birthplace of Russia's new generation of officers, and allow us to proudly continue a tradition of being the most capably led force in all of Russia, even as the time relentlessly marches forward. Even in death, the old line shall forever guide and watch over the brave officers of the Red Army. Get more daily army XP, division attrition goes down, less out of supply, less training times, more max planning. Sounds quite good. Alright. Resource treaty? Sure, why not. Diplomatic standing? Because we can. Why not? If you wonder about that, please go ahead. Great! More receptiveness and more army XP. Sounds good to us. Yes. More free infrastructure? That'd be great. Well, it's not really free because it all costs PP, but that's alright. We can only get one point... No, we don't get one. We get 0.94. Okay. Hurrah! We need friends. Yay! We got more PP. Civvies. The factories of Tumen. The region of Tumen is a key industrial sector in West Siberia, but to say that these factories are in a sorry state would be put it mildly. The region suffered for many years under the mismanagement of Kaganovich's regime, and the industries clearly paid a heavy price for the incompetence of their former tyrannical ruler. The final nail in the coffin came with the storms of war which raged over the breadth of the remnant republic not too long ago. Now that they've been overthrown, we can begin repairing and expanding the factories of Tiumen to get them back into running order once again. Tiumen is an important keystone in the industry of West Siberia, and once it has been revived to its former glory, our economy will surely see great benefit. War is past, war is present, war is future. Fyodor jogged along the path, always enjoying the fresh air and the warmth that came with the exercise. Being a soldier in the Third Army was tough, training nearly 16 hours a day. Fyodor dreamed of working in his fields, owning a farm, and getting away from the deadly battles and the strict officers. He wanted to work on his own schedule and be somewhere peaceful. Fyodor thought back to when he was a young man and just joined the Third Army. He had fought in the many wars past, the collapse of the West Siberian People's Republic, fighting off bandits of Warlord era, and joined the campaign to reunify Russia, or West Siberia. Was he just in it to fight to see some action? The wars to come would be just as brutal, if not even more. What was stopping them from leaving? Then he recalled one of the major things that he had learned in the army. The Third Army was always supposed to protect the people. If he gave up and decided to take up a life of farming, he would be giving up on the families he had sworn to protect? Russia seemed like it would be embroiled in battles for decades to come, and enemies of the Third Army surrounded them, waiting to strike. Fyodor couldn't abandon the people. Russia needed him to continue the fight. If it was a job of the Third Army to protect the people, to serve Russia. Very good, very good. Nice. Cool. And, you know, let's not do this one, because we don't need to make any more civvies, so let's save our PP for that. I think that'd be good to do. Just save our PP for now. Yeah, I mean, we're only building pretty much infrastructure at this point, so we're kind of okay. Actually, if we do that, we only get how much every day? We could spend more to get more political power, but I'm kind of okay. You need to get more consumer goods and stuff. One, two. I mean, that's already looking pretty good, so. The airfields are good? Yes. The vast majority of the air facilities in West Siberia are now but bombed out husks of their former selves, thanks to the relentless bombing campaigns unjustly waged upon us by the Hun. Sirkut's airfields, however, are a bit different story entirely. Look at this. Great. Efficiently maintained by the formerly independent free aviators, these airfields are nearly in mint condition, and will make up some of the largest Russian air facilities still in operation. Now that the airfields have the weight of an entire nation behind them, with the opportunity to expand and improve the airfields far beyond their previous capabilities to better serve our fledgling air force. Great. So now, we can go ahead and do what? We still have three down there, which is fine, and promote new officers. For 7 days, we get more army XP, we get two more generals. Cool. We're 50 PP? Why not? Ah, screw it, just get more PP then. Oh, and let's see who wins, Anarchists or the NKVD? That'd be kind of cool to see, actually. Alright, we're running out of things to build around here. Hopefully, we don't have to go to war with the... technically... eastern side of Europe, but western to the soldiers to the west of us. But we'll see what happens, of course. Eyes inside the machine is not bad. That costs more, though. Incentivizing your allies. Well, it's come to the point where sentiments in the Euro military district has grown so high that there's a significant portion of the populace that shares ideas about binding our nations together into one. We could take advantage of this fact by covertly sending funds to groups that are sympathetic to our cause, and there are two ways about this. I think I've heard of this before, so. Could we discreetly support them, or support them openly? We're going to go ahead and... actually, there's a 40% chance public support for unification increases, greatly increases, foreign influence revealed, or 70% chance greatly increases... I'll do this one. That's fine. I've read that one quite a few times. Let's do that one. Improved jet cast. Very, very nice. Very awesome. And it's almost 70, so I'll just go and grab that one. That's fine with us. We build more cities anyways. Hey, if you want to read about that, please go right ahead. Boom. Nice. Cool. Oh, we have no manpower. God dang it, that sucks. Well, I'll get the cast later on. If we actually do unify, I'll probably just delete most of their army. Maybe flush out these guys, but for the most part, I'll probably just delete their army. Cool. And the expertise of Zlatous. Oh, there goes Yemen. Aviator aces. The plane flew over the barren, icy tundra. Skillfully maneuvered by its pilot, picking up a draft over the lake, Yevdokia Belshanskaya had been yet to see any German planes for years. Now the threat came from Western Russia and the Central Siberia. Although she hadn't seen much action yet, she was ready to defend West Siberia and the military district. Things were different now under the control of a central government once again. They're no longer free to do whatever they please, having to follow orders from the military on the ground. Things were just like the old days of the Soviet Union in a way. Continuing to fly her plane, she veered down towards the Ural Mountains, checking to make sure no scout patrols from West Russia cross the border. Yevdokia didn't care for who was in control down below. Up in the skies, her free aviators had a duty, and that was to protect Russia in the air. Free aviators tomorrow. Or today. The brilliant engineers of Zatovs were masters of the craft, standing at the very forefront of arms production even when compared to foreign designs. Their weapons can be found all across throughout the broken nations of Russia, and with good reason. The guns of Zatovs are cheap to produce, reliable in the field, and pack a serious punch. It's easy to see why the warlords of Russia would be willing to pay a king's ransom to get their hands on such weaponry. With Zatovs and its arms production facilities under our control, it would make a great deal of sense to continue funding of these arms designers. This time, however, they will serve us rather than themselves. The Zatovs factories will help equip our military exclusively with some of the most cutting-edge weapons and equipment in the world, putting us leagues ahead of our rivals, which would be great. I guess we follow up with revolutionary designs. Our improvements to the armor of our tanks already seem promising indeed, but you can only modify these ancient piles of junk for so long before severe flaws begin to emerge that cannot be fixed by welding or even more spaced armor. Our mechanized forces need new, modern designs to go into battle with, and a current model simply won't do. With both the refurbished tank plant at Sverdlovsk and the Ural automotive plant at our disposal, we can and will do better. Our technicians, some of the most brilliant in other generations, will soon find themselves hard at work designing the armored vehicles of tomorrow. New and improved tanks outfitted with the latest munitions and armor designs will dominate the battlefield, while modernized IFVs will carry troops into the fray and support them with enough firepower to level a city block. Foundations of the conference, if you'd like to read about that, please go right ahead. Prepare. And foreign trade deal proposed, if you want to read about that, please go right ahead. Let's see. And better industrial expertise. Great. Mutual training, I guess we can do that if we want to. Up here, now we have improved ground support efficiency. More air XP, land, air, more ground attack factor. Yes, please. Yeah, we'll just keep spending people for now, it's fine. Concessions and cooperation, mixed results, and shaking hands. Great. US-Japanese talks end, while ours are just beginning. Peace into unity, peace, and Russia. Forward. Yes. Attention is negative 10, and reception is 118. Pretty good, I'd say. Awesome. And then we'll do Eyes Inside the Machine. One of the most regrettable incidents of the West Siberian Wars was the degree to which the enemy was able to infiltrate our ranks. No part of our assailant was safe from the civilian sector to the military, and the spies were a constant danger to our operations. With the establishment of the Internal Security Bureau, we were able to put a stop to most of this madness, but now that the region has been unified, we face larger threats than ever before, and currently the ISB is in no state to handle them. Therefore, we will direct increase funding to the ISB to help expand their operations. This time, we will no longer cower behind our defenses and root out infiltrators as we spot them. The ISB will find itself on the offensive, launching daring espionage missions into enemy territory and using highly advanced computing technology to break their codes. The Bureau will become our vigilant eyes and ears, and threats to the nation will never go undetected again, which is pretty good. Hey, yes! Decrease in poverty, if you'd like to hear about that, or both of these, please go right ahead. Yes, I love better poverty. That's good. And they agreed to joint exercises. Great. Oh, that's 12 billion, huh? That didn't help us out much here at all, but whatever. Hey, at least it's not 12 billion. At least it's 10%, not 12%. At least that's good. And then invincible and legendary. Comrades, the reforms are nearly complete. Our troops have finally earned their status as the most well-trained professional fighting force in all of Russia. Our formidable tank fleet grows by the day, and the indomitable war machine of the Urals has finally sprung to life after nearly two decades of slumber. It took a great deal of time and effort, but the Red Army has been transformed into a truly modern force, more than ready to face whatever challenges the future has in store for them. Uniting West Siberia was only the start of our journey. Soon, we will turn our attention to the total liberation of the country. The people of Russia cry out for justice, and the Red Army is dutifully willing to answer the call. Our invincible troops will become a nightmare to the would-be tyrants of this broken land, and our legendary generals will be the ones who lead them to victory. Nice. Anything up here? Nope. We have six, though, huh? Incentivize pro-unification factions? I guess we could. Our diplomatic weight is just really high. There you go. Why not? Keep getting more PP, please. A tragic day. Eyes inside the machine. Awesome. And get some AKMs. Or ends. It looks like ends. Go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, almost 6. Running at full speed. Very nice. And then, may our work be fruitful. If you wonder about that, please go ahead. Reject their honeyed lies once and for all. Hope to Russia after so long. Oh, this is good. After so long. Our diplomats leave the conference with their new compatriots in tow and a treaty declaring the Soviet Federation of West Russia's integration into the Ural military district. These two nations, already so intertwined with each other's economy, military, and politics, have now formalized their unity by sharing a banner and name. The work in adapting the Soviet Federation of Western Russia's laws and administration remains. Our union can no longer be interfered with or interrupted by other ill-intentioned nations. With malice towards none and charity for all, we have bound one more wound on the motherland's bleeding Soma. Yet may more festa. Beautiful, my friends. Absolutely beautiful. And what do they have for the military? 37 divisions. Not bad. With you guys, 9. We're going to have a lot of tanks. I'm just going to convert you to our division already. There you go. Let's go 4. And there you go. And then... there you go. And then... there you go. I think that'll be enough. 54 infantry divisions that are 40 combo with each. That's already pretty good. And then we have an additional 15. They're only 20 combo with tank divisions, but I think that'll be okay. Let's just make sure we set up these guys appropriately. So we're going to need a lot more infrastructure here then. Look at that manpower. Beautiful. And we have more free cities. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's so good. Look at all this stuff. Oh, man. What was the WRRF for these guys doing? Did they not care about what they were doing over here? Must not have been. Beautiful. Beautiful. If these guys are still fighting, we actually might just go to war. Oh, everyone agreed about this stuff, please go ahead. We might just go to war with Kazakhstan then. I mean, our roads are looking great. There's so many resources here in Russia. Russia has a lot of natural resources. There you go. Very nice. We're trying to build some air bases here too, so that's good. Cool. Oh, we can probably integrate these guys. Arkhangelsk, yes. Vyatka's good to do. Samara is probably really good. Onega is probably not too bad. Komi. We'll just do all these places eventually, so. Great, we can close out of that. We can't do that probably anymore. And let's finish up this focus, and then we will go ahead and reunify. Crisis in Nanjing sounds like a problem. Alright, so now we're 23 billion because we have so much military spending. And actually, it's a lot of civilian spending, so if you want to get better agricultural methods, please go right ahead. Modern mechanization, incentivizing your allies. Well, if you want to read that, please go right ahead. Maybe that one too. And, well, we're done. But not really, because now we must do this. The Russian People's Union. Beautiful. Extra influence? Yes, please. I'm kind of just tempted to just go to war with them anyways. How many divisions do they have? I might just send down tanks. Ah. Oh, they're authoritarian socialists. How many divisions up to... yeah, you guys can do it by yourselves. We need way more tanks, but let's begin with... So, like I say, for all the campaigns, I've read this series quite a few times, so if you like to read about these, please go right ahead for the atomic stuff, just because it's always the same thing. So there you go. There. And chase the sun. Not too bad. But, ooh, there goes Egypt, a union of peoples. Under the leadership of the High Marshal Batov and the Council of Generals, destiny has been generous to us, and we've grasped it. West Russia has now been reunited under one banner. However, now is not the time for too much celebration. There's still much work to be done just beyond reunification. Our administration is stretched to its limits, and we must work fast as possible to quickly integrate the people of West Russia into our burgeoning state. We've endured so much up to this point that our present obstacles are nothing. Thus, let us march on with ever greater resolve, knowing that we can and will be victorious. Beautiful. I'll keep building that stuff up for now. It's fine, too. Ooh, support weapons. Nice. It's almost 1970, so... gotta keep that in mind. More land attack would be very bueno. Make sure you guys are all doing that. You will go over here. We could train them, but I don't feel like training them right now, so... nice. Let's deploy some casts. Finally. Actually, we can train you guys then. You should be good enough to train. End of the atomic age would be great. And just get rid of it. I don't even want to see these guys. There's a lot of different templates they had. Wow. Look at how many templates they have. Wow. The AI loves making templates. They're ridiculous. And we got the focus done. Great. A union of the people. Restoring Russia. Yeah, we can still do with this stuff. Let's get some more PP first, then, probably. Restoring Russia. West Russia definitely had some of the worst of things when it came to the terror bombings and the chaos after the West Russian War. The people here deserve better, which is why proper integration is of the highest priority is at this moment. The Russian people's union must be sustainable before it can be strong, and right now, we are overstretched. We will drop a plan to properly build up the region and to once again bring order to these lands. Absolutely. Approach scientists. Well, I'll save our PP for now. You know what? I just kind of want to go to war with them. I'm not sure if we can actually do this stuff. And these guys are too busy killing each other, so let's go to war. I wanted to integrate more, but whatever. A new office. They'd moved Batov to a new office when they took West Russia. A bigger, more opulent one. Did he deserve it? Batov would have said no. The office was paid for by the blood and sweat of his men. He did not look forward to the bigger office if he reunited Russia. More blood, more death. It was hard to focus on the victories rather than the mistakes that inevitably happened. Friendly fire incidents, faulty equipment, failure of intelligence, and just bad misfortune. It did not feel right to excuse oneself by rationalizing it all as a learning experience. He and the council were competent at war planning and strategy, but would it be enough? Could they finally reunite Russia and one day take Muscovine? The phone rang and he picked it up. Sir, the colonel, the council of generals have convened and they would like your presence. Of course, I'll be right there. Batov hung up the phone and grabbed the things he needed for the meeting. All the worrying could wait. There was still work to be done. And pee-pee to get. Hey, one a day. Not bad. So we'll probably do... What do we want to do? Bezniki? Pam? Let's do Gorky. Just because they have a lot of tanks around there. And we still have some coffee, too. The council's plan? Beyond properly reintegrating the West Russian regions, the Council has decided to properly convene to design the strategic plans for how best to do things. High Marshal Batov and the other members of the Council will be meeting for a week-long conference. In an early analysis, the majority of the obstacles seem to be more civilian-related, which would come with its own challenges. Thus, it would be important to have the proper goals and principles for embarking on enforcement and proper implementation. Very good. Let's grab some of this, too. A little bit ahead of time, but that's no problem for us. Well, it's not bad. But hey, at least we peacefully reunify, which is a great, great thing. Love it, love it, love it, love it. Love it when we peacefully reunify. Don't have to waste lives. And, oh, there we go. Perm. We get an event here, right? I believe we should. Oh, they're doing very well, actually. I thought we're supposed to get an event. Oh, I got better rifles, which is very nice. Since we're here, let's come down here, too, and grab that, too. There you go. Thank you. Ah, a Red Army? Pavel Batov was signing paperwork when the door to his office opened with a click. It was Ivan Bagramyan, his second in command, and more importantly, his closest friend. Closest living friend, that is. It was so hard to think of Konstantin as dead sometimes. It made Batov wonder if the man would approve of his recently rather heterodox thoughts. You called for me, comrade? Bagramyan asked, shutting the door behind him. Yes, yes, I did. Please have a seat. When the other man had, Batov continued. Apologies for the short notice, but I have something I need to get off my chest. B-man looked surprised to hear that. Anything, comrade? Is the paperwork getting to you? Batov shook his head with a small, almost sad smile. No, 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 nothing like that. I was just thinking, this Russian People's Union we've created, to be very honest, is not really a socialist state, is it? Yet we still call our army a Red Army and proudly display a hammer and sickle. It's very peculiar, isn't it? Bagramyan's eyebrows raised at this, and he seemed unsure what to say, so Batov continued. So I thought then, why continue to do such an unnecessary things? Surely they're very useless for our time and energy than playing at being something we aren't for a long dead man. A silence fell between the two, and before Bagramyan could respond, Batov started laughing, making Bagramyan crack a polite, confused smile. Well, never mind what I said, Ivan Kristoforovich. Let's leave the future tomorrow and talk about the past for today. How long has it been since we've spoken? Just the two of us. Ah, just the two of us. Was it the Battle of Moscow? No, it was over in Samara, comrade. Samara, that's right. We should go visit someday. Oh yes, price controls? The economic situation is dismal in the Russian People's Union. The Council has had many heated discussions with the leading economic experts on how best to move forward, but the Council has decided to overrule their free market suggestions, much to their dismay. Price controls still will be set in place for basic necessities such as food, fuel, and water to combat inflation. To placate the economists, the Council has explained time and time again that these are but temporary measures and new long-term options may be implemented in the future, but stability is a new priority as of now. Great! Difficulties in the conference? On the second day of the conference, Batov thought the entire conference was in bad shape. It had been another day of arguing how to best go forwards, and which problems were most pressing, how best to do this, and the like. It was sometimes heated and other times bone-crushingly boring. Batov would have been lying to say that he was attentive the whole time. Right before the end of another frustrating day, Pavel and Batov stood up and asked the men to go back to their seats. Gentlemen, although it is merely day two, I find our progress lackluster. I'm speaking now to remind you that the people of Russia rely on us to get this right. More than half of the issues plaguing our territory are not military related. As such, I must emphasize we cannot approach them in a military manner. Batov paused. He wished he'd written out more of a speech before having all those eyes on him. Before him, there were strategists, tacticians, and logistical experts, but not a single civilian. He continued. We cannot afford to be stubborn here. We cannot crush poverty beneath tank treads. Yes, officially we made the final decisions, but we must lean into civilian leadership and the specialized expertise they possess. The strength of the Russian people is a strength beyond military strength, and now is our chance to prove that. One day, when Russia is reunified, when the Nazis plague our lands no longer, the people of Russia will have the luxury of beating our swords into their plowshares. On that day, when the rest of the world sees the nation of Russia, what will they see? I hope they see a formerly humiliated and war-torn people who, against all odds, stood up with the courage and determination to forge a better future. The applause was thunderous. Very good. Ah, Night Vision. That's even good as well. There you go. Awesome and happy new year, everyone. Happy 1970. I think next what we'll do... we'll do probably one of these. Let's do established closed facilities. Oh, budget boost. There we go. Very nice, and let's go ahead and do some of this. Nice! Alright everyone, so we're doing established closed facilities once again, and let's go ahead and do maybe the next generation to help us decrease coring times. How about that? It is time for a new wave of recruitment to replace a casualty sustained since all of the reunification conflicts. It should be easy to cook up a new recruiting campaign. Our copywriters already have a catchy name, the next generation. The focus will be on our professionalism. No longer are we a group of conscripts with rusty rifles, but we are now perhaps one of the most competent armies in all of Russia now. There's now proper logistical support, real training from veterans, and most importantly, proper compensation. The future of Russia's security is here. Will you be part of the next generation? Oh, we're gonna award them too. I forgot about that. Yeah, cool. Go in, guys. We'll probably be able to do them actually pretty darn quickly. So we have more civvies. We do need way more tanks. We'll do that one. Why not? Let's go up to 30. There you go. It's gonna cost us more, but that's all right. Great. And we could do this gain. You might as well. Awesome. Followed up with what? More cost. Well, why we fight? War is a terrible thing, and no person easily salivates after death as men do after caviar. The people of Russia need a reason to fight. The Council of Generals approved a propaganda campaign to remind our people why we continue onwards without stop. Our quest for reunification is not yet over. One half of Russia still remains out of our grasp. Muscovine is still under fascist control, and Russia is still weak. These are Herculean tasks, but we must try. Therefore, we will send out the best artists to draft and to design new slogans, posters, and other forms of media, so that once again the Russian people may be united under one whole flag. Hey, and they're gone. Great! Freedom from oppression? Freedom from persecution? It's not bad. Let's do appealing to the populace first. For the most part, West Russia has accepted our new administration, but there still remains a few insurgent holdouts. On the military front, our best men are trying to dislodge any strongholds that yet may remain, but counterinsurgency is much less about bombs or bullets and more about hearts and minds. The starry people of Russia's anarchy have suffered too long under tyrannical strongmen and warlords. Fair. We ourselves are not a civilian institution, but we have no other plans to be tyrannical. Even the Council of Generals hope that one day Russia may be ruled without martial law. However, the people of Russia do not know this. Beyond words and propaganda, however, the Council of Generals recommends action to build trust. We hope to integrate civilian advice and put input within our ever-growing administration going forwards, and the people will know that. Great. Pavlodar, why not? Alright, these guys did great. Let's spread out our soldiers a little bit more, because they might be suffering from attrition because they're so bunched up together, but we'll see what happens. Train if you do need to, and let's send you guys down here yourself. Yeah, I don't think the anarchists will have that much... Oh, they actually did win! Look at that! They actually won! I don't think they'll be able to do that well against us, because our army is just looking really good. Like, ridiculously good right now. What are we missing besides tanks? 600 tanks. We're making almost roughly 4 tanks a day. That's really not too bad, actually. You guys want to see this stuff? Thank you. Oh, we're using tactical bombers? Oh, well, whatever. And let's go ahead and actually do this one next. A foundation for research. Very good. The promise of payback. One more thing, Comrade Kreiser. Do you have the forms for the new uniforms? I could have sworn they were supposed to come in by yesterday. It was Kreiser's time to wear swear now. I think I got a batal, but I didn't know what they were, so I just put them at my desk. I'm sorry. Let me go get them. Kreiser opened up the desk, removing various sheets of paper in the drawer when he came to open upon an old faded picture and paused. It was a picture of him, his parents and uncles at his bar mitzvah. Whatever happened to them, he wondered, when his heart began to sink. He hadn't heard of them since the war began, which meant, no, it couldn't have happened, not to them, by God, not to them. Bata was going to ask Kreiser what was taking him so long when he saw him staring at the picture and forgot about the forms for a minute as he let the fates of his family sink in. The two sat in an office for what seemed like an eternity before Kreiser began to speak. How long will it take, comrade? Kreiser asked. How long will it take us until we get back at the Krauts for everything they took from us. Vatov blinked. Soon, he replied, but we have to work to do first. Remember that. We have a motherland to reunify, and one day everyone in our nation can avenge what has been lost. Comrade, remember that. And we can do this stuff too, but I want to integrate everyone, every place first. I think that's better to do. But reintegrate the remnants. It was a pity that the first West Russian war did not take back Muscovy, but we will never stop applauding for our predecessors, the West Russian Revolutionary Front. They were a truly a veritable army, and our hope is that they would come in from the cold. True, the Russian People's Union is no longer an organization based upon Marxist-Leninist principles, but no doubt we would hope that these old soldiers would reconsider. Those who are still young enough to fight may still have yet value as non-commissioned officers. Very, very true. My apologies about this. And let's go back over there. And even veterans who are not fit for a frontline combat to survive would be a valuable asset to actually be as members in our officer corps. The Internal Security Bureau has also been collecting leads. There are rumors that some ex-commanders are hiding under new aliases since the reunification. Let us use our intelligence assets and find them. We mean no harm towards the former members of the WRRF. In fact, from one group of old soldiers to another, all we wish to do is give them one more chance to reunite Russia and to drive out the fascists from Muscovine. Very, very good. And securing heavy industry would be pretty darn nice. Eagle Soar. Yeah, this stuff is okay. Let's do Grants for Academia. Few ever pity a fool, and if things do not change, Russia as a nation would remain as a nation of fools. So many years of anarchy and terror bombing have permanently set back the Russian people from proper progress. We have no delusions to think we would instantly catch up to the superpowers in Germany, Japan, or even on the far shores of the US of A, but the time is now. But the time to start now. Our council has decided to consult the academics about our first steps, and they have recommended providing grants to incentivize the populace. Let us hope that these investments will pay us great dividends, and a deal for hiring soldiers. Well, a deal for soldiers in hiding. In the capital of the Russian People's Union, two men are being escorted up the stairs towards the High Marshal Batov's office. The guards look bored as if they were escorting yet another two dignitaries being brought up to the High Marshal. The two men, this morning, were suddenly woken by angry knocking at the door. At the door were seriously-looking Internal Security Bureau agents asking for Sergei Akraminyev and Alexander Altunin, respectively. When the two met up at Batov's HQ, the two gave the other a look which asked, just how did Batov and his men find out about the real names and new addresses? The two ex-WRRF generals followed the guards into the new large office of the High Marshal. He dismissed the guards and asked the two men to sit down. Batov clasped his hands together and began, was the trip here comfortable? Did anyone mistreat you on your trip here? Because Batov smiled a little bit. I could have had them court-martialed if you say so. The two men sitting were silent and seemed nervous. Anyway, you're probably wondering why I have you here today. Both ex-Revolutionary Front high-ranking generals. No, I'm not here to arrest the two of you. I want to make a deal. What sort of deal? Asked Altunin. Join our people on the general staff. We need all the help we can get in the coming days. Both of your experience would be incredibly valuable and would be appreciated. Batov paused for a moment. Would you two be interested? After all, we are still the Red Army. Supposedly. The two men looked at each other. Akraminyev then said, give us a few days to think about it. Take all the time you need, so long as the final answer is yes. Yeah. That'd be nice. Wow, look at that. That's a lot of cost. Oh, baby. And then we'll do address their uranium problem. Not bad. And we still have quite a few focuses to finish. And I really wonder what the war is like going to be between us and the Siberian Free Territory. Hopefully it won't be too bad. Very good. Very good. And I'll do Almaty next. Great. How are we building up right now? Even more civvies? That's great. We have a lot of civvies functioning. Wow, that's pretty good. But let's go ahead and do the Eagle Soar. The time has come again to warm relations with our wealthy and powerful patron across the ocean, the U.S. We've already established formal diplomatic relations as a regional power, and the time has come to deepen relations. Further economic or military support would do much to help us reunify Russia. As such, we are planning a diplomatic visit to the U.S. with High Marshal Batov leading the procession. We hope to remind our backers that their previous support was not in vain, and neither would our future requests be wasted either. Our diplomats are already beginning to draft a few of our economic potential concessions for their aid. May your visit be received well. Let's hope so, because we would not want to piss off the Americans who support us so well so far. But you never know. You never know what might come with things. Man, once Toolbox Theory hits, I really do wonder what things are going to be like with the whole economy stuff, because it's going to be kind of wild. But followed up with the securing heavy industry. Although our men were given stern orders to prevent collateral damage, much of the fighting has rendered heavy machinery and factories in West Russia offline. It's one thing to prevent damage to the factories, and another to restart them. The Council of Generals has passed executive action for our passing or existing industry to focus on providing the necessary components and items needed to restart the offline factories. Even more anti-tank just in case. And since we're here, these tank divisions are only 20 combat width. That is not ideal. Give us some more infantry and stuff like that, and then stuff like this, and stuff like that. fine. Let time go on, actually. It's fine. Just because I want to get through the focuses relatively quickly. We're going to need way more tanks now. Way more tanks. Oh, this stuff is okay. Nice. Great. And what did the Americans say? Actually, how many tanks are we out now? Minus 5,000. It's only minus 5,000, guys. And freedom from oppression. Mother Russia will need all the help in the wars to come, so why does she relegate their daughters to be at home? The time has come to open up the restrictions to women in combat roles. They already serve with diligence and rear echelon roles, and it makes no sense to restrict women from the frontline duty if they meet the high standards of training. High Marshal Batov has been briefed on this and demands that these restrictions be lifted immediately. A soldier of the motherland in D.C. Batov had made it to Washington. He did the customary diplomatic song and dance, giving presents, saying the magic words to beg from the leaders of the country. He was a soldier, no more, no less, and he did not feel suited for this sort of work. He felt that he was waiting this time here, yes. Wasting time. The work here was important, but he wished only that someone else could have done it. It was all very exhausting until the men from Washington brought him to Arlington. A tour guide led Batov and the entourage throughout the cemetery. Batov was as solemn as he could be, as they were essentially passing through hallow ground. Some graves were as old as the Civil War, and others were recent as South African War. He marveled how clean the graves were and the effort put into maintaining the grounds. It was mostly uneventful, save for his translator telling him the comments from the tour guide about the history and background of the cemetery. For the final trip of the way, they had arrived at the tomb of the unknown soldier. The tour guide had explained how the monument was in remembrance of a U.S. soldier whose remains could not be identified, but would be remembered nonetheless. The guide had timed for the explanation well since when he had finished. It had been the time for the changing of the guard. The entire entourage watched with bated breath as the sentinel did each and every step of the routine with pinpoint accuracy, precision, and timing. When it was all done, Batov had said something to his translator, asked for a bathroom, and promptly left with his guards. "Well, what did the High Marshal say to you?" the Americans asked his translator, curious of what he had prompted such a sudden departure after the long silence during the tour. "The High Marshal is very grateful that you have had the generosity to show him Arlington Cemetery," the translator replied. "He had excused himself to be alone for a few moments. He will be back shortly. What do you think of Arlington? He was deeply moved and told me that he wished the people of Russia could do the same. A soldier does not weep, he sobs." And the oil crisis erupts. And we sob for the oil crisis. Very deeply. Very, very deeply. Ooh, 30 billion. This is one of the highest annual deficit I've probably ever had in any campaign. That's really bad. Wait, look at that. That just went up by 0.1. Not bad. Not too bad. And we'll probably updo this one next. Yeah, I don't want to lose political power yet. We still need to get more cores, but expand the Kurgan mine seems pretty darn important to get more infrastructure. So, and then we'll read this one and this one, and then we'll do that one too. Oh, to serve Russia, yes. And army professionalism rapidly improved. That's not too bad. And we got one day left. Freedom for persecution is up next. For far too long, Russia has been a lawless wasteland with it carved up between a bandit lords, fascists, and other wicked men. It was a free-for-all, but the average person got it the worst. Might makes right, as those wicked men say, no more. Although our rush will be a mighty one, it will also be a fair one. Our leading legal theorists are now tasked with rehauling our legal system. It must scale up to include those larger populations and territories, as well as making the courts more fair and less corrupt. The Council of Generals have recommended certain legal goals for the theorists. A more fluid appeal system, offering military service in exchange for lighter sentences, and more use of jury trials, the list goes on, in a quest for the justice of all of Russia. We mustn't neglect the justice of Russia's people. Let it be done. More better free repair and more stability? That's pretty good. That's pretty darn good. Get one stability or one political power every single day. That's not looking good. Oh, my goodness. Paining me as I see that. Oh, we have so much more we could build. Oh, so much more. So much more. Keep making them civvies. Our deficit's way too high. And keep doing that too. That's fine. It's only money, right? It's only money. Followed up with freedom from annihilation. Our conflicts have run the entire gamut from anti-bandit raids to counterinsurgency patrols to full-blown conventional war with regional warlords. Our armed forces are already blessed with proper discipline and training. We hope that if we make some issues clear on the theoretical level, then we may begin to formalize it into everyday tactics. Therefore, the leading military experts and the Council of Generals are looking to conduct a formal review of standard operating procedures as well as rules of engagement. No longer will we merely claim to be a truly professional army, but to become one as well. Less attack, but better leader experience gain and more war support? Not bad. A new beginning. Rodion could remember the day that in court, as though it was yesterday. He had said too much to the police. His lawyer tried his best, and a simple deal from the judge, 5 years of hard labor or two in front of a frontline combat unit as punishment. He chose the second option. At the training camp, he was assigned to Misfit Company. It was a penal unit full of former criminals and convicts, murderers, thieves, captured bandits, none of them innocent. Well, a few claimed otherwise about how their juries were brain dead, their lawyers were clueless, and how the military judges of the Russian People's Union had just had it out to get them. When the jesters and funny men got around to ask him what got him in his unit, he answered honestly, "It was my last job." Everything was perfect to steal the money, and we got caught. A rat sold us out. The jokers frowned in a rare moment of pity for a fellow thief, before one blurted, "Well, we could still use your skills. No end of odd jobs around here, especially when the regulars have got all the nice rations." The other men laughed and hollered at that. Over the din and mirth, another one chimed in. "Rodin, is it? More like Raskolnikov." Rodan grinned and replied, "I'm sorry, I don't steal from old grandmas like you." The barracks erupted in hollering and laughter. We few, we merry few. Very good. And then to serve Russia. "After all of our hard work, my friends, it should be time to see the fruits of our labor." After so many weeks of brainstorming, managing from within his office, High Marshal Batov expressed interest in having a personal inspection of a few places. However, in typical Batov fashion, he requested that they are kept as surprise inspections. Very well, may he be impressed. Yes, may he well be impressed. Misfit Fortune. Rudian heard about the mine-clearing duty before. He prepared himself for the worst when they were given this mission. Just him and the company marching across a suspected minefield and clearing with blood and flesh. Luckily, it was not like that at all. The company was given a crash course on minefield clearing practices. The officers to assign them an experienced ordnance disposal expert to oversee the whole assignment. The whole company was given what little protective gear they had. A few layers of flask vests and these hot, heavy helmets with poor ventilation. Heck, the Russian People's Union had the idea of setting up a first aid triage just beside the field they were working in. Rodin could not help but be a little anxious with how well they were treating his company in the job. The company was tasked with clearing a drivable corridor through the middle of the road. They were not worried about the anti-tank rated ordnance. They were too big and would be triggered by human prodding and would have required a whole vehicle's weight to set them off. However, the dudes planted anti-personnel mines as well. The company was organized to go in shifts because they had the manpower as well as the physical strength of looking for such things. Rodion watched the shifts preceding him, put on the protective gear in the sweltering heat, as well as a few daredevils who didn't bother. He was told that the complacency just killed just as well. Those darn metal detectors gave out plenty of false positives, and more time was spent digging up those loose shrapnel and random junk in the mines. Kaboom! A plume of dust and smoke came over the front column of the D-miners. A few men were shouting for medics. Rodion sprinted over to try and drag the injured further away from the danger zone. Men wreathed in pain and their blood painted the dusty road. Rodion began to drag one of the injured away from the danger zone. The protective gear on the man only slowed the attempt. Another man came over and grabbed the wounded man's other arm and started dragging him as well. Rodion and his comrades were making good ground now. Just a few more dozen meters away and they could get him in the triage. It was going to be a long day. Oh boy, that just sounds terrible. Absolutely terrible. Oh boy. And my apologies about that. Apparently Discord just pinged me. My apologies. I usually have it muted, but I don't know. Sometimes it just pops up. So, if you haven't joined my Discord server yet, do please consider. It's totally fine if you do. If you don't, that's totally fine as well. We just talk a lot on there, and sometimes people try to organize multiplayer games on occasion. Cool. And I do want to see if there's any sort of event. There should be some sort of event to serve Russia, right? Surprise inspection! The base commander thought it was strange that such a luxurious-looking motorcade had showed up at his training camp. He thought it was yet another general in the council with more time than sense showing up for regular inspection. When he saw the unmistakable great coat billowing in the wind, he knew who it was instantly. He rushed out to greet the High Marshal and stammered out, "Sir, this is surely a surprise, and I'm not sure if your aides had told you but this camp trained our ex-combat units?" "Yes, they are a surprise." "They had, and the surprise was part of the plan," the High Marshal replied as he shook the base commander's hand with a smile. The base commander took him on a tour of the whole base. They had a kill house to train for urban warfare. Live fire drills with real ammo and an honest-to-God obstacle course. Of special pride with the High Marshal were the field rations the men had. No, they were not the most tasty meals, but they were more reliable and edible and far better than what they had before, courtesy of some beneficiaries in D.C. All this had made his heart swell with pride for his army. They had truly become a formidable fighting force, but would it be enough? They had not yet reunified the entire motherland. Muscovium was still occupied by the Reich. And truly a terrifying opponent if there ever was one. Batov watched the men resting at the end of their physical training session. The men may have had discipline, skill, and courage, but sometimes war was beyond virtue and skill. Sometimes war was about luck, and Batov wasn't sure he was an especially lucky man. All that he and Russia could do were their best. Absolutely, and we're almost done with our focus tree. And I'll be honest, I'm ready to go kill off the anarchist to our east. I'm ready. I hope you guys are ready too, because it should be a lot of fun. Actually, 4 infantry divisions. Did I throw a tank on these guys? I did not. I was thinking about throwing some tanks on there, but this is looking worse, actually, now. That's not good. Of course, we are training them, but what else is new? Actually, as long as they're all regulars or trained, I'm kind of okay with what they got, so go and do that. Oh, bad supply. Well, that doesn't help us out. Actually, yeah. Let's send you guys up north, then. Spread you guys out a little bit better than this. You guys should be doing relatively okay. How is infrastructure around here? Pavlodar is actually not too bad. Oh, there we go. Look at this. Let's do this again. More cores, please. Thank you. More infrastructure, please. Thank you. Looking pretty good. pretty darn tasty, if I do say so myself. Yum yum. Of course, we are in war economy, which really hampers our civilian factory production, so. And then, chase the sun. And it'll be literally, by the time we're done with that, pretty much time to go to war and begin invasion talks. Let's see how strong they are first. Oh, we have no PP. That's not good. They have a ton of manpower like us. We have 500,000 people. They have a lot of divisions, too. So, of course, they might have some light infantry, some probably regular infantry. They might have 40 combo with infantry, because the AI does like to use 40 combo with infantry from time to time. They don't have a lot of anti-tank. Not that much, really. They have a few of these, a few planes. They have quite a bit of artillery. Not too much. A few planes, of course. And a lot of guns, which makes sense. And Iraq is killing itself, but what else is new? Where are our other planes? Fighters looking not too bad. Ah, there you are. There you are, my friends. Go one here. There you go. And, oh, you're technical bombers. That's why you're not pretty hot. There you go. Chase the sun. Great. Great, great. And now we can make more pee-pee. And we still need to integrate Yorlsk. But happy 1971, everyone. Can we peacefully reunify? That'd be really cool. Next, I need the olive branch. Let's see what happens. Cool. And let's access the foreign goods. So, receptiveness and tensions 15 on both sides. We have way more diplomatic weight than they do, which is awesome. Come on, guys, give it up. We don't need conflict here in Russia. We're actually working on this stuff, too. Go down. Look at all this infrastructure we gotta make. Civvies first, civvies first. What do we believe here? We believe in civvies first. Spend, and make more. You know, at this point, research doesn't really matter too much. This is that one, too. Thank you. We gotta make sure our artillery is really top-notch. That'd be really cool if we can reunify with Siberia. I don't think I've ever reunified peacefully with with two factions in one campaign. I've done it once. I've done, you know, peacefully reunify once with, you know, different groups, but never with two in one campaign. But that's why we're here to try. Actually, how's society improving? Oh, let's see. Accept the deal? Yes, please. That'd be good. Making a lot of people. Look at our stuff. 6.5. Oh, let's keep doing this too. Partner accepts. Great. Non-aggression agreement? Let's go look. So it's about 6.5. 5.25. Agriculture is slowly going up, even though it doesn't matter anymore. Poverty is getting a lot better done. Like I said, technology doesn't really matter too much. Army professionalism is still getting better. And let's grab some of this. Yes, please. Keep on speeding through. And actually, since we're done with integrating stuff, let's advance the development stage first. And grab whatever we can for improving our technology. No. Oh, there's nothing here. Usually there's something here. Maybe I already went past it, but whatever, that's fine. Just keep speeding on through. Military construction. Technology doesn't mean as much anymore. And, you know what? It's 70, almost 72. It's actually only 71. It's not even 72 yet. But let's do some resources. Nah, we're actually okay. Let's do some of this. Anti-air, yes. Yes. Good. Our diplomatic settings are really, really good. Mutual training, why not? And develop this stuff. Yes, please. Nap. Oh! They rejected the nap. That's not good. Why would you reject naps? Naps are awesome. Spending is 30 billion. 31 billion, basically. Oh, boy. Come on, guys. You're not going to be able to win against us. We are far too strong for you. We have tripled their diplomatic weight, so. Tensions are 30. Receptiveness is at 40. Cool. And let's see what happens. We're currently getting 2 a day, which is actually really nice. Tanks are not looking too good, though. Hurrah! Yes! Alright, not bad. Oh, let's do that one, too. So, receptiveness is 70, attention is still 30. Let's see, can we train anybody else here yet? Can we duplicate you guys again? Yes, we can. Not too much here. Oh, we have a lot of this stuff here. Enhancer diplomatic. I mean, we don't need to do that anymore. Now we got nothing to do with our peepee. I'll just go and see what they do. How's our civvy building up? Doing quite well, actually. Quite well. A lot of build. And of course, we need to do more to build, too. Cool. Ah, yes. Border treaty, yes. secure peace with them. Oh, and Iran has fallen apart. Yay! Alright, and what do they say? Incentivizing allies. We'll do this one, because that's pretty good for us. 80, that's not bad. Declaration of Friendship, we might do this one. Oh no, a declaration has been signed. Oh, civilian budget boost, keep spending it for my now. 31 billion, it's getting worse and worse. I'm not sure how or why, but okay. Second Night of the Long Knives, very good. Choice of Carrot, decrease diplomatic weight by 3. Is that worth doing? Choice of Carrot, offer diplomatic concessions. Well, we can continue doing this one, I guess, as well. Conference, sure. We'll do the conference. 30% more land out of tech is really good. Must rally the Russians. Oh, concessions and cooperation. Well, let's do this one. Checking the air. Come on, come on. Begin final unification talks, I guess. 90. Tension is still not super high, but we'll see what happens. Keep building, 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 building. Look how many we won. Well, actually, I'll read about that. Just a little bit better already, just in case. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 and a half. That's a lot of civvies. We have almost 300. And 2 dockyards. Not bad. Come on. We have a lot of PP now. Actually, since we're waiting so long anyways. That'd be nice to get this a little better. Army professionalism, political interference is down here. We're almost a professional army, so that's actually really good. I do kind of want to kill them. I kind of don't want to be doing this peacefully, but we'll see. Alright. They won't beat us. Offers cabinet positions if we can't beat them. Sure, why not? 148. Come on. Come on. Can we do it? Can we peacefully reunify? We took out Kazakhstan, so. And our core population is 45 million, which isn't too bad. Not too shabby. Come on, Siberia. Come on, give it up. No one is a 200 yet out of 240, which kind of sucks, but it's all right. So Oleg Nebogatov, as well as conservative democracy with probably Yeltsin, which I will probably play as after this campaign, and Batov is 92%, which is pretty nice. Come on, begin final unification talks. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Future training, because we can. After so long, we did it. We flippin' did it. This is the first campaign I've ever done where we peacefully reunify with 2 factions. Nice, look at that. How strong are these guys? Oh, that's pretty easy to beat. 21 of these. Yeah, actually, see, they did make 40 combo with infantry. That's interesting. That's exactly the same division we have, so. Goodbye. My friends, we've done it. We have peacefully reunified Russia. So the only war we really had was in the first one with all those guys in Western Siberia, but we've unified this side and then that side. We could integrate all these guys, too. But my friends, it is time to do what Marshal Batov set out to do with... Where is it? I think it's at the top. General Batov, Batov reunifies Russia. Long live the Marshal. Awesome, my friends. Awesome to serve Russia. Suvorov's nightmare. Pavel Batov stumbled as he walked through the battlefield. He could hear screams emanating from all around him. Some were distant, while others sounded close enough to be coming from right beside him. The marshal, however, was unable to tell. He could not keep his eyes open for more than a second, try as he may. He felt as though he was staring into the sun while he tried to look around, despite the pitch darkness. Eventually, the screams grew more distant, and the pace of explosions began to slow. Batov noticed he could finally open his eyes, and saw that he now stood in what appeared to be a massive graveyard, with white crosses marking graves for as far as the eye could see. Turning back... towards his front, Batov noticed with a curious statue in the distance, standing beside the monument were several men wearing the uniforms of a Red Army general. Upon drawing near, however, he noticed he could not make out their faces no matter how hard he tried. The figures began to clap as Batov moved closer to inspect the monument, which was a large, blood-stained depiction of himself. As he reached out to touch the statue, he heard one of the faceless men speak, "They all died for you." The marshal uttered a muffled gasp as he awoke. Frantically looking around, he felt relief wash over him as he realized it was just a dream. The details of what had occurred in his sleep began to fade away, and Bartov took the sunlight beaming through this bedroom window as a sign it was time to get up. An important strategy meeting concerning Moscow was to take place that day, and the marshal wasn't about to make a habit of being late. It was just a dream. But unfortunately, that concludes our part of this campaign, playing as good old Grand High Marshal Pavel Bartov, who looks pretty handsome in his 1970s portrait. But if you enjoyed this campaign, leave a like, subscribe if you're new, check out my Discord link in the description below, and I will see you tomorrow, or at least in the next video, where we'll go back and maybe try a certain Boris trying to lead the country into greatness. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a tremendous rest of your day.